Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, just one more minute, sir. We'll start, sir. 1 minute, sir.
Okay, yeah.
So good evening, everybody. Today we are having our second master class in the glaucoma series by Dr. Ramakrishnan sir from Aravind Tirunelveli. So the topic of today's lecture would be wound healing in glaucoma surgeries and role of antimetabolites. Over to you, sir, for your lecture.
Okay. Good evening. Today's topic is wound healing and the role of antimetabolites in glaucoma plastic surgery. So in this class, you know, just I want to emphasize about something about the introduction about the anti-glaucoma surgeries, then the wound healing in general, and why wound healing is so important in anti-glaucoma surgery, and what are the other factors that can affect wound healing, and then the role of pharmacological, how you modulate wound healing, either by pharmacological methods or any other methods. Then, of course, what are the other implications and complications in cases with anti-glaucoma surgery. But here, now, anti-glaucoma surgery, you know, it's evolved to a large list of anti-glaucoma surgeries in the present scenario. Before, you know, we have a lot of old procedures like full thickness filtering surgeries, and then partial thickness filtering surgery, and then of course minimally invasive glaucoma surgery, and then of course glaucoma implant and the other anti-glaucoma surgery. But whatever the surgical thing you will have it now, till now, the gold standard anti-glaucoma surgery is the trabeculectomy. If we come to the full thickness filtering surgery, this is because this also you should know about the why there is so much of change in the past 4 or 5 decades. In full thickness, you have mainly this iodine glazes. It's a surgery where you incarcerate iris into the sclerocardial wound. This will act as a wick, and that facilitate the passage of aqueous humor from the anterior chamber to the subconjunctival space. In that, there are so many modifications: single pillar, double pillar, cross pillar, iodine glazes. That's the one aspect. Second, full thickness filtering surgery is where famous ileus trephany. Ileus is a very famous ophthalmologist from RIO. He is a UK surgeon, and he was in RIO about 8 years back in RIO Chennai, Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, Chennai. He popularized the technique called Ileus trephany. In that, you just remove your button of sclerocardial button, a full thickness button, and that through that opening from aqueous humor will drain into the subconjunctival space. The second aspect. Third is the cyst thermosclerostomy. That's again another full thickness where you use both knife and cartridge to enter the anterior chamber. The main purpose is mainly to prevent the healing so that you can keep the patency of the tract. That's again But the main problem with this full thickness filtering surgery is, you know, it's because of the patent full thickness opening, there's an excessive drainage that leads to overfiltration. Overfiltration, shallow chamber, incidence of hypotony, choroid detachment, and of course the blood related complications are all very, very high. That's why they were looking for some modification whereby you can have a regulated flow of the aqueous humor from the anterior chamber to the superior, guarded filtration surgery. That's a partial thickness filtering surgery. In that, the full thickness opening is guarded by a partial thickness clearal flap. That is a tubercle activity. So in all these, this today's talk is mainly for the tubercle activity. Tubercle activity was the wound healing and other modifications. And of course, now the modern anti-glaucoma surgery, especially the minimally invasive glaucoma surgery mix, where you have so many types like iStent and iPass, so many things are there, no? There it is no role, this wound healing doesn't have no role. Because here in this surgery, generally, normally any general surgery if you take, you know, it's main, what we want the wound to heal. That's the main thing. You would have read in surgery, when you were doing our surgical posting, wound to heal. There also you will have many phases of wound healing. But here, we don't want the wound to heal. Some wound, the conjunctiva, especially the conjunctival wound, we want to heal, but the opening, what we made is the trabeculectomy artery, we don't want the opening to close. That's also how to keep this balance. That's the main importance of this topic today. And of course, the first it was described by Devaker. Devaker is a very famous ophthalmologist from Spain. And he only find out some sort of filtering cicatrix as the surgical treatment for glaucoma. Something like a blob like structure in the limbus that will facilitate the flow of aqueous humor from the anterior chamber to the subconjunctival space. And also many, then of course, as I mentioned, still the trabeculectomy is the gold standard. And the posterior full thickness, now they serve mainly, as I mentioned, it's only a historical interest, nobody is doing nowadays. And the wound healing is generally beneficial because it allows us as an organ to deal with the accidental surgical trauma. The eye undergoing filtering surgery is a special case wherein you have excessive wound healing can cause a filter to close, as I already mentioned. And incomplete healing may cause a flat anterior chamber and hypotony. So how to keep it as a balance? And the main success of surgical procedure designed to treat glaucoma depends on the prevention of excessive wound healing. And of course, iodectomy is an example. Once you do an iodectomy, it will not close. And similarly, the success of glaucoma filtering surgery depends on the modification of the limbal wound healing. So before going to that subject proper, this is the one thing we should, all of you should know. In trabeculectomy, what are the ways in which the aqueous is drained from the anterior chamber to the subconjunctival space? These are the various possible mechanisms that has been postulated and also demand proved also. One is through the transconjunctival route to the tear film. And second one is directly absorbed by the subepithelial blood vessels. Then, of course, the anastomosing endothelial channels of cut capillaries. Then, of course, whenever you do a trabeculectomy, you are inadvertently do a cyclodiuresis cleft. Cyclodiuresis means the separation of the ciliary body from the iris from the ciliary, sorry, ciliary body from the ciliary spur. That's a cyclodiuresis. So it is through that cleft also aqueous will dry. Then of course important one is the conjunctival lymphatic. Another important route is the through the cut end of the slings canal. When you do a trabeculectomy ostium, the ostium should contain a portion of the slings canal also. The slings canal, trabecular meshwork, and desmoid swarming and posterior lip of the sclera. All these things constitute the trabeculectomy posterior. Okay, and these are four ways. So this is the duty of the ophthalmologist to limit the healing process. And also it is interesting clinical observation that the difference in outcome between two eyes are also not same. So each eye behave differently. And what are all the factors? So before going to the wound healing proper, what are all the factors that influence the or have adverse effect that can affect the glaucoma filtering surgery outcome? One is the patient characteristic, we'll see one by one. And second thing is what is type of glaucoma, then what type of filtering surgery you are doing, and then status of the conjunctiva, whether conjunctiva is virgin or it is adulterated with some other inflammation or infection or some other drug, something like that. And the, any history of previous intraocular surgery. So all these things are important when you do a case of a trabeculitis. All these things we have to keep it in mind. And of course, age is one factor. Younger individual, the success is not that high because they will have very high healing process. The fibroblast population is very high, so they will go for a failure very early. As age advances, the success is good. And of course, race also plays a major role, especially as in population and African Americans when compared to white. The African American, the healing is very fast and they go for failure. Then of course, another one of the controversial thing is the, especially when you do trabeculectomy, previously before the advent of use of antimetabolites, we used to excise portion of the Keenan's capsule. Because Keenan's capsule is the major reservoir of the fibroblast. So some studies support the tenorectomy. Some studies say there is not much of a difference between eyes that had tenorectomy or without it, and both the success rate is almost same. That's a thing they have mentioned. Then of course other things, and a large portion of the year, this is a study, it's a very old study, but nobody's not giving much importance for the Keenan's capsule. And of course, it's the main, one of the old studies that Mowney is a very famous ophthalmologist. He found out that this tenorectomy did not enhance the filtration success, but it resulted in a thinner blub. Thinner blub means the blub is thin and moderately vascular, it can be a functional blub. Then, of course, other type of glaucoma is also one of the important things. One is the anti-segment neovascularization, especially neovascular glaucoma of any cause, whether it's CRVO or BRVO or diabetic recovery. Then, intraocular inflammation, especially VVT glaucoma. Then, presence of the aphakic and pseudophakic glaucoma in aphakia and pseudophakic glaucoma also may affect the success of filtering surgery. Then, of course, primary glaucomas. Primary glaucoma, their success rate will be good when compared to secondary glaucoma. Then, of course, type of filtering surgery with full thickness, so because no question of full thickness nowadays, and only partial thickness, trabeculectomy is done. But other thing, especially the surgical and postoperative complications, is a very, very important thing, especially when you do any vitreous loss, any hyphema or inflammation or flat AC, all these things may affect the success of the filtration surgery. Then, of course, presence of conjunctival inflammation is again one of the important thing, and there you will have increased fibroblast proliferation and reduction in the globular cells in the conjunctiva. So, In glaucoma filtering surgery, so you see trabeculectomy, one of the important thing is the chronic use of the anti-glaucoma medications. Because nowadays we have a lot of anti-glaucoma medications, starting from beta blockers to the ROCK kinase inhibitors. All the anti-glaucoma medications, they will have some sort of effect on the conjunctival cytology. So, thereby it will affect the success of the filtration surgery, leading to the cicatrization, scarring and fibrosis, block, and thereby you will have a failure. So what will happen if you use anti-glaucoma surgery for long term? It is associated with increase in the myofibroblast proliferation and also increase in the macrophages and lymphocytes and mast cell population will be more. And another important thing is the reduction in the goblet cell population, which is a good cell, is very much reduced. And also bulbar congenital metaplasia. Another important thing is the breakdown of the blood aqueous barrier, especially when you use prostaglandin for long time. No? This will cause a subclinical breakdown of the blood aqueous barrier. That's very, very, this, if you have a breakdown, you will have irides and other things. So that will further, it will lead to the failure of the filtration surgery. So how to tackle all these problems with the anti-glaucoma medication? That's also again an important question. These are all the various, this is available in all the major textbooks. The scoring, risk scoring, how to calculate the risk for the success of the filtration surgery. This is ocular and patient risk factors. Ocular, mainly the type of glaucoma, so we have and other associated ocular conditions like congenital pathology, etc. So they are given 0 to 4 square. So 0 is a mild risk and 4 is a high risk patient. Then of course patient, the age and where the race, also other important things, there's also they are given score. This is very, very important to modulate the wound healing, especially when you use antimetabolites. And you have to look into all these things. Then how we are, what are the features of a functional blood? How to, what are the typical features of a functional tuberculosis blood? Usually will not be a localized one, it will be a diffuse one with moderate elevated, it's not highly elevated blood, it's moderately elevated, plus with the surface. And third one, you see, previously we used to say it's avascular, anemic blood, but now acceptable vascular, it should have two anemic blood. It can have an acceptable vascularity with the microcystic changes. At the same time, the intraocular pressure should be very, very normal. That's the ideal feature of a blood filtering blood. So in the case, we must know about what is this. Sometimes, you know, you can have this type of blood also. That is called encapsulated blood. This is, you can see between 4 to 6 weeks of the filtering surgery, especially in the younger individuals and the secondary glaucomas, and also those who had a very long-term use of anti-glaucoma medications, you will have such a picture. If you don't intervene it early, no, this will lead to problems. So how it will look like? It will look like a localized dome-shaped blood, localized, otherwise we used to, it's just a compartment of anti-chamber. This is just this compartment, because this is covered with a very thick cuticular membrane which will not allow the aqueous to come out into the subconjunctival space. So with a very high intraocular pressure, it's a very, very, very tense, and you will have injected blood, a lot of corkscrew vessels over the blood, usually appears 2 to 3 weeks after the surgery. If you have to, you have to intervene early, otherwise it will go, you have to go for a surgical revision of the blood. So this the surgically fashioned fistula, what we have fashioned during tuberculectomy, it failed to drain aqueous humus successfully because of the excessive wound healing in three locations. One is the fistula may be closed. The fistula what we have created may be closed with the granulation tissue in the immediate postoperative period, in days, especially within a week. The fistula may be closed with the granulation tissue. Number two is as I already mentioned, the formation of the encapsulated blood during the first few postoperative weeks, 4 to 6 weeks of the filtration surgery. Later, the filtration blood may flatten and you will have a scarring and the cicatrization of the epithelial tissue, and usually it will take 6 months to 1 year for the late failure of the blood. So these are the three time duration where the blood go for failure. So for this, to understand the wound healing response, this will help to plan a more rational approach to preoperative management, how you have to manage the patient, because so that you will not have all these adverse effects during filtering surgery, how you manage preoperatively, and what are the precautions you will take during surgery, and how you will manage the post-operative care for the patient, especially when you do all these things. These are the various types of the filtering blood. So if you take any wound, the major events in wound healing is in the three phases. One is within a week, that's the inflammatory phase. So in that case, you will have a clot formation, cellular migration, especially mainly the polymorphonuclear lymphocytes, and then liberation of the growth factors. See, in the first 1 week of the surgery, especially the phase one is the inflammatory phase. Then, of course, phase two is the proliferative phase. This is within weeks. 4 to 6 weeks, they used to say. Here, the new blood vessels formation of the new blood vessels and cellular migration, let's say, especially monocytes, migration of the cells, and then cellular division. Lot of fibroblast proliferation and division. This is one of the culprits for the blood scarring and secretion. So, how to avoid it? Then, of course, protein synthesis and wound contraction. Then, the remodeling, whatever happened, especially scar tissue and everything. The wound will not, because after some time, the remodeling will happen mainly because of the collagen synthesis and the degradation of the collagen. It will take a month together. You cannot separate each stage separately. So this is overlapping. The first phase will overlap the second, and second will overlap the third phase. The first, as I mentioned, sucker immediately after injury and last for several days. And also growth factor acts as a mitogens and hematoattractants for WBCs and fibroblasts in the injured area. Next, proliferative phase, mainly fibroblasts with the biosynthesis of the new extracellular matrix. That's one thing. And then wound contraction leading to the, this lasts for several weeks and leads to formation of the granulation tissue. Lastly, you will have the modeling phase. And these are various things. Again, so I don't want to repeat all these things. Three phases. And how this wound healing can be retarded so that you can have a very good successful filtration surgery. So what are all the strategies you can adopt for this surgery? One is the minimal trauma to the conjunctiva, episclera, and iris when you do the surgery, because all these things are very, very important. You should have a very minimal trauma to the tissues in the eye. Use a plain forceps and cautery. Then there are certain things you can do with the drug. That is pharmacologically, you can modulate the wound healing. One is the use of cycloplegics. Cycloplegics will play a major role in the anti-glaucoma surgery, especially trabeculectomy. Mainly, one is the diminution of the exudation of the plasma proteins. This again, the plasma protein, especially in the aqueous, will cause a lot of it enhances the wound healing. We don't want the protein to be liberated. And for that, you can use only the cyclopregics, either comatropine or atropine. Because this atropine is not only dilates the pupil, it will stabilize the, normalize the blood occasionally. That's the main thing it does. It gives rest to the eye, and also it normalizes the blood occasion barrier, and also prevents the formation of the posterior synechiae. Another important thing, especially in glaucoma, it will maintain the normal depth of the anterior chamber. You can ask how atropine will maintain the depth of the anterior chamber, because it is cycloplegic. So when the ciliary body is paralyzed, what will happen? The diameter of the ciliary body will become more. Your zonules of the lens are attached to the ciliary body. So once this diameter is more, this will cause stretching of the zonules, and thereby the equator of the lens is pushed peripherally so that lens become flat. So once the lens become flat and you know, it will go back and to maintain the anti-chamber depth. That's why any filtration surgery, whether you do it for angle closure or open glaucoma, second glaucoma, always we will give the cyclophagics, especially the first 2 weeks, two weeks to 4 weeks. Most of them we use for 6 weeks also, some of the anti-glaucoma surgery in angle closure glaucoma. And also avoid topical myotics. It will increase the blood occlusive barrier and also increase vascularity and reduce the pouring of the proteins. Then of course, role of corticosteroids we'll see later. And also you avoid intraocular hemorrhage during surgery, good exposure to the limbus. Then of course, prevent iris incarceration into the wound. That's also very, very important. Then, of course, the role of corticosteroids is very, very important in cases with anti-glaucoma surgery, especially those who are on long-term anti-glaucoma surgery. You know, we used to stop the anti-glaucoma surgery at least minimum 1 week prior to the filtration surgery, number one. Then you can give oral isosorbide Diamox to control intraocular pressure. Third one, you see, most of the time we used to give topical steroids. This topical steroids will help to increase the goblet cells and also reduce the fibroblast proliferation and also to stabilize the blood vessels barrier. And then second thing is the intra-local, intraoperative or postoperative administration of the anti-neoplastic agents, what we are going to see in the second part of the talk. And to reduce the fibroblastic proliferation. And third aspect, the agents that can interfere with the synthesis of the normal collagen, such as beta-aminopropionyl, BAPN, or penicillamine. This is, even though it's a beneficial effect to the eye is documented, we are not regularly using this, chelating agents. These are all chelating agents. This will have effect on the collagen synthesis. So we are not using in the anti-glaucoma surgery, but we regularly used in some of the other cornea they are using. So already mentioned about the role of steroids and mainly steroids reduce the capillary permeability and also inhibit the phase of the early inflammation. Corticosteroids is coming. Sometimes we usually during surgery we used to give subconjunctival dexamethasone 0.2 milligram, that's 0.5 ml. And also some people, especially in uveitic glaucoma or with repeat filtering surgery or the patient had any bad conjunctiva or any tertium surgery, they used to give subconjunctival champsulone before 1 week before the surgery. That also this will have a cytosterol effect on the fibroblast. And postoperatively, you have to give a minimum of the 8 to 12 weeks, depends upon the indication for the surgery, whether it's a primary glaucoma fixing surgery or secondary surgery or secondary glaucoma. We have to give the steroids for 8 to 12 weeks in tapering doses. So there also Moorfields Eye Hospital, they have formulated this scoring system for use of this antimetabolites, whether it's a 5-FU or mitomycin, depending upon the severity of the disease. According to that, they have divided into three categories. One is the low risk, intermediate risk cases, and the high risk cases. What are the low risk patients? There are no risk factors, it's a primary glaucoma, no use of a topical anti-glaucoma medication, conjunctiva is virgin, and all these things. Then intermediate risk, you see, those who had a topical medication, previous cataract surgery, and other things. Then these are the high risk patients with neovascular glaucoma, uveitic glaucoma, and chronic conjunctival inflammation, and aphakic glaucoma, those are the high risk patients. So in that case, what are the things you have to take into consideration? That's a thing. So coming to the anti-metabolite, There are so many antimetabolites have been tried in anti-glaucoma surgery, like 5-fluorouracil and mitomycin and daunorubicin and all these things. But only two were found to be more useful. One is the 5-fluorouracil and the second one is the mitomycin. But after long term use of 5-fluorouracil, the complication rate, side effects of the 5-fluorouracil is very, very high. So slowly people have started going to mitomycin, and they are not using care. Also in all our hospital also, rarely we do use 5-fluorouracil. Most of the time we use mitomycin only. But we should know this 5-fluorouracil also. It is nothing but the fluorinated 5-methionine analog. Its mechanism of action is in vivo. This 5-FU is converted into 5-monophosphate nucleotide, which interacts with the enzyme. This is very important. This enzyme thymidinate synthetase, and thereby it inhibits the TMP synthesis. This is one thing that inhibits the TMP synthesis and fibroblast proliferation. This has got a self-specific cycle, specific action on the space of the wound healing. This blockade of the thymidinate synthetase inhibits the DNA synthesis, and while cellular proliferation of both RNA and protein continues to liberate. And this leads to the imbalance in growth, so non-compatible with the cell survival, and will have a very good wound healing. And there's one initially about four decades ago, they were started using, there is 5-fluorouracil user surgery group, surgery group was there. So their 3-year follow-up surgery using 5-FU demonstrated a statistically significant enhancement of the IOP control less than 20 millimeter and avoidance of the resurgery for the pressure control. That's a conclusion they have come up with that. That's a very long back. This study was conducted about 30 years ago. So you must know about the 5-FU, how it is available. It is available as a aqueous solution. This is a 50 milligram ampule, and 50 milligram ampule, it's each ml contains about 50 milligrams. So five total strength is 500 milligram. Each ampule contains 500 milligram, and each ml contains 50 ml of 50 milligram of 5-FU. And in glaucoma, there are two major mode of application for this 5-FU. One is subconjunctival. Initially, when we started using this 5-FU in 90s, we used to give subconjunctival injection. That's not one injection is not enough. You have to give minimum of 1 week to 2 week, depending upon the indications. How much you have to give? You have to give 5 milligram. I told you each ml contains 50 milligram. So 5 milligram is 0.1 ml contains only 5 milligram. So once daily, at least for 1 week, and 180 degree away from the filtering site. You have to give 180 degree away from the filtering site. That's a dose of the 5-FU. And main problem with this 5-FU is highly epithelial toxic. It is highly toxic to the epithelium, corneal epithelium. So even with one or two injections, people will start having epithelial defect, SPK, and then epithelial defect. And chronic injected eye. Eye will be so red and painful and watering, and everything will be there. So you will not further able to continue the medication. That's one of the major drawback of the using the 5-FU subconjunctival injection. So later what we thought, why can't we use a subconjunctival sponge, this one. So same strength of this mitomycin, sorry, 5-FU, we have used in a sponge, the same 50 milligram per ml 5-FU, we will choke it in a sponge and keep it in the subconjunctival space for about 2 to 5 minutes, depending upon the indications. So it's a primary glaucoma or a secondary glaucoma. Then you have to thoroughly irrigate the area with the BSS. And then in the post-operative period, if the patient need any antimetabol, then we can give a subconjunctival antimetabolite. Another use of this 5-FU is the, when you do needling, in cases with the failed filtering blood, you do needling, needling of the blood. In that case also, you can give a 5FU in 0.1 ml, just 5 milligram the 5FU you can give. So what are the indications for the 5FU? This is for completion sake, I am telling now, we are not using 5FU regularly. So all primary glaucoma filtering surgery in blacks and young people you can use, and eyes with the previously failed filters, and then aphakic and pseudaphakic glaucoma, neovascular glaucoma, and uveitic glaucoma we can use. It's mainly contraindicated in cases with active corneal diseases, known hypersensitive to drug, and also in patients with multiple filtering surgeries with severe scarring of the conjunctiva. These are the various complications, adverse effect of the 5FU. As I mentioned, SP case, epithelial defect, flammatory keratitis. So it's very, very difficult. Most of the patients, they will come with multiple filaments in the cornea. They will have a severe dragging pain in the eye. Always I will be irritable and watering, and they will not be able to open their eyes. Then of course, Dellen formation and also epithelial pigment line formation. You will have what you call it, the advanced border of the what you call it, you can have a ferris line, they can get and also complications in pre-existing corneal conditions you can get. So that's the reason why you are not using mitomycin commonly nowadays, because of severe toxicity and efficacy is not great when compared to the mitomycin. You have to give subconjunctival injection too. So second important anti-metabolite which is commonly used all over the world is the mitomycin. That's the mitomycin C, they used to say. Why it is commonly? Because it's a one-time application. It's not like a 5FU where you have to give multiple injections and other things. And the second one is the, it's very simple also, very simple. And but we have to keep it in mind, 5FU is epithelial toxic, but mitomycin is toxic to the endothelium. So it's highly toxic to endothelium. So patient with the endothelial decompensation, we should not use this drug. And also, whenever you have intermittent ACNG during surgery, you should avoid using mitomycin. So before entering the AC, we should use mitomycin. So what is mitomycin? Mitomycin is nothing but an anti-tumor antibiotic, and is isolated from the Streptomyces cispitosis. In 1956, it was isolated, and usually it was initially used in recurrent pterygium. MSR has used a lot of mitomycin in recurrent pterygium, but one of the important complications is the scleral necrosis. So you have to give the patient drops twice daily for 3 days, but what will happen, patient will use drops for days together and they will come with the scleral necrosis. That's why now they have stopped in using the pterygium. And so this adjuvant in glaucoma filtering surgery found to have a long-term success at cellular filtration site and patent to keep the sclerostomy patent. It was first demonstrated by Chen et al. In I think it's in China. First up, he tried mitomycin in the glaucoma filtering surgery in the year 1981, and later it was popularized by the farmer. And mainly it is a patient and physician friendly and convenient, and lack of cardiac epithelial toxicity, and also mainly contributed to growing preference for intraoperative MMC over the postoperative 5FU. So how it acts? Mechanism of action is mainly inhibiting fibroblast, conjunctival fibroblast proliferation in vitro by affecting the DNA synthesis by inhibiting the cross-linking between the adenine and guanine. This is the main mechanism of action of the how it will inhibit the conjunctival fibroblast proliferation. This mainly it inhibits the cross-linking between adenine and guanine. That's the one thing. And also inhibitor effects are independent of the cell cycle, and short exposure are sufficient to suppress the proliferation. This is independent of the cell cycle. That's what. Coming to the dose of the mitomycin. Because initially, when we started, because we were the first to use mitomycin in our country, India, I was the first to use. That's in the year 1990. So at that time, we didn't have proper study about the how much concentration and what duration you have to use. That's the main thing, concentration and duration of this mitomycin. So people were started using 0.2 milligram per ml to 0.5 milligram for about 2 to 5 minutes, depending on the type of glaucoma. But initial period, no, we had a lot of complications. We had the blub, especially the blub-related complications. The blubs are so pale, large cystic blub leading to overfiltration, number one. Then blub-related complications like blub leak, blubitis were very, very high. Then, of course, the hypotony. Hypotony and hypotony macropathy are very high. So then we, with the help of Alan Robin from John Hopkins, we had done a study that will come to it later. So here, the surgical technique is also very, very important. I mainly used intraoperatively at the sclerostomy site. And as I already mentioned, there is an inadvertent entry into anterior chamber. This is absolute contraindication to MMC use because highly toxic to the corneal epithelium and the endothelium and the sclery epithelium. Once it enters the anterior chamber and the posterior chamber, is highly toxic to endothelium and also ciliary epithelium also. Ciliary epithelium will go for atrophy and there is no more secretion of the aqueous humor and the eye will go for hypotony. One of the reasons for ocular hypotony following MMC use is the atrophy of the ciliary epithelium. So how it's available in vial, I will show you. This is available with some mitomycin C, it's a powder form. It's a 2 milligram vial. It's a 2 milligram vial. So in glaucoma, we normally use 0.2 milligram, 2.4 or 0.5 milligram per ml. That comes to 0.02% to 0.05%. So they may ask, how will you constitute the solution? How will you make the solution into 0.2 to 0.5? Suppose this is usually diluted with your distilled water. And its efficacy, once you reconstitute the solution, you can keep it in the refrigerator and you can use it for 2 weeks. It will be pink in color. Beyond 2 weeks, it will not be very effective. Suppose you want to use 0.2 milligram or 0.02%, you have to dissolve in 10 ml of distilled water. 10 ml of distilled water. If you want to use 0.04% or 0.5 milligram per ml, you have to dissolve in 5 ml of distilled water. Suppose you want a higher concentration, 0.5 milligram per ml or 0.05%, both are same. Now, in that case, you have to dissolve in 4 ml of distilled water. That's how you have to keep it in mind, how you to constitute this solution. So, depending upon the indication, you can use the different concentration of the mitomycin. So a cellulose sponge is, you have to choke in mitomycin and then you have to keep it underneath the conjunctiva. Just you should not take a scleral piece, just outline the scleral flap dissection and push the cellulose sponge much more posteriorly so that you can have a posterior flow of the aqueous humor and you will have a very diffuse flap. You will not have a limbal based flap. This is a pharynx based conjunctival section. Pharynx means the limbus is the conjunctiva is dissected at the limbus and is deposited towards the pharynx. That's why it's a pharynx based. Suppose if you cut the conjunctiva here, no, and you just repose over the limbus, it's a limbal based. So limbal based you can do trabeculectomy either with limbal based or pharynx based. Limbal based filtering surgery, no, you will have a localized blood. One thing. Number two, you see, you can have a ring of steel phenomena, they used to say, where you will have a special limbal base, no, the surgical incision wound, you know, they will have a granulation tissue with vascularity form and they will not allow the aqueous to flow posteriorly. So, this is called ring of steel, so that's why you will have a localized blood. That's why now most of the filtering surgeries are with the pharynx base blood. So that you can put the mitomycin sponge much more posteriorly and then you have to thoroughly wash the area with copious amount of this to the water. But now, we have started using mitomycin injection also. Instead of using sponge, we have started mitomycin injection. That gives much more better result when compared to the sponge, but we should be very, very careful. Very, very careful. This is mainly given in the dose of 0.2 milligram per ml, and you have to take 0.1 ml and the equivalent of xylocaine you have to take, and you have to inject much more posteriorly, about 8 millimeter posterior to limbus you have to inject before dissecting the conjunctiva. Then you have to spread the injection site so that the mitomycin will diffuse in the subconjunctival space. Then after 2-5 minutes, you have to do the routine surgery. That's how you do mitomycin injection. This is a study what we have done in 1991. And so that gives a lot of insight into the use of mitomycin. So here, mainly 0.2 milligram per ml for 4 minutes with less concentration for more duration, better result, especially in blood, better blood formation and better control of the intraocular pressure. That's what we found out in our study. But in cases of the secondary glaucomas like neovascular or uveitic, then you have to go for higher concentration for more duration. Then what are the indications? We can use all, because now we have started use the mitomycin in all cases of glaucoma, starting from the as a primary procedure itself with low concentration. And especially in cases with a high risk for filtration failure, like already mentioned repeat surgery and all these things. And also in the failed case with high fluorouracil, we can use the primary tropicostomy agents, and also uveitic and neovascular glaucoma and the combined surgery. So again, it's complications of mitomycin. It's, I told you, it's not toxic to epithelium, it's highly toxic to the endothelium. And because of that, you know, you can produce desmoid spores. And also, because the blood is very, when compared to 5FU blood, the mitomycin bloods are a little avascular and large cystic, and any time it can go for a conjunctival leak. So it's mainly done, diagnosed with the Cedar's test. You most probably heard about the Cedar's test, where you put a drop of fluorescein and observe the slit time so that the aqueous will flow through the leak and over the cornea. There's something like a false. This is a positive Cedar's test. And in heavy dose, you can have a scleral necrosis also. Suppose if you have a scleral necrosis, then you have to go for a scleral patch graft. You have to close that necrosis with the patch graft. And of course, when you use mitomycin, you should take care that the free margin of the conjunctiva should not touch the mitomycin sponge. Suppose if it touches the free margin, the conjunctiva will not heal, then you will have a conjunctival only. That's a very important thing. You have to be very, very careful. Then, of course, the rate of blood-related endothelium due to thin cystic is very, very high when compared to 5FU with the mitomycin. And also, long-term hypotony is less with the 5FU, which is more with the mitomycin. And also, higher incidence of cataract has been reported. In our study, we had about 14% of them had a cataract in 1 year follow-up. So, in this juncture, you should know about this terminology, that is hypotony and hypotony maculopathy. So, anything intraocular pressure less than 6 millimeter is said to be hypotony. And usually, it is between 1 to 9% patients with hypertony may go for maculopathy. So not all cases of hypotony will go for maculopathy. Certain individuals, as I already mentioned, so direct toxic effect of mitomycin on the CD epithelium. So certain individuals who are at the risk of going for hypotony maculopathy and hypotony, especially younger individuals and high myopes, suppose if you do your filtration study in cases of the myopes, there also chances are more. And the third important thing is the pigmented glaucomas. Pigmented glaucoma, especially younger individuals, when you do, they are also more prone to have a hypertony, maculopathy. And then we have whatever condition where the sclera is thin, again it's a risk factor for development of the hypertonus and maculopathy. So how you, in hypertony, you will have only, the pressure will be low. You will have a normal antechamber, and also you will have a fundus will be the same like before, and there will not be any reduction in the visceral acuity. But in maculopathy, there is a sudden, abrupt, gross reduction in the visceral acuity. Abrupt reduction in the visceral acuity, thereby the patient will have a marked reduction in the visceral acuity. So what are the things you will have? You will have a trade-off with disc edema, and then of course macular edema, and then retinal folds. These are three important things in hypertonus maculopathy: disc edema, macular edema, and retinal folds. And intraocular pressure will be very much less. Sometimes you will not be able to record. I will be very soft, very, very soft. And also in such a condition, no, you cannot do a very good refraction also, because of the unsteady, with each movement, the eyeball will become deformation of the eyeball. So you will not be able to have a good shadow. So that's the main important thing. And you can have a choroid detachment also. That's why any hypertony, the cataract formation will be very, very high. And then of course, these are these blood, you know, this because of the large cystic blood, anytime it can go for blood leak and blebitis, something like infection of the blood you can have. Once the infection spread intraocularly, you can have a hypopia, and then it can spread into vitreous, causing the blood related endophthalmitis. It's very, very one of the medical emergencies. So once you develop a such a case, blebitis, you have to be very, very aggressive in your treatment. You should take a conjunctival swab immediately and look for the, you have to start broad spectrum antibiotic, topical, intracameral, intravitreal, and also intravenous injection. Then depending upon that, you have to do vitrectomy or any other. These are various types of blood. It's a management is very, very it's a long topic, so not in this class. And of course, how you will inhibit the collagen, inhibitors of collagen, organization and others, just for completion sake, I am telling steroids, of course, this may play a major role in anti-glaucoma surgery. Then, of course, the agent that interferes with the collagen activity and synthesis is the BAP. It's already mentioned about the beta-aminopropionitrile, which they were not, used so far. Of course, penicillin they are using in is a chelating agent, especially band keratopathy. In cornea, they will use. There's one more chelating agent, this is hydroxyproline, is another chelating agent, which has got an anti-collagen activity. Then oral colchicine also. Previously, especially when doing Marchino implants, some of you heard about the Marchino implant, so one of the older generation implant, they used to give oral colchicine to improve the success rate of the blood following the Marchino implant. So it's a, that's called as the Marchino cocktail. They used to call this Marchino cocktail, which constitutes the oral colchicine and the steroid and all these things. Then, of course, donorubicin. Initially, some studies were done with the donorubicin, but nowadays nobody is using with that. And also, bleomycin, again, another anti-tumor antibiotic with some collagen blend started using, but with not much good results. And also, cytosine, arabinocyte. And then other anti, it's all in the early phases. Early phases, they have tried all this, even cystine, bleomycin, and thiotepa, but nowadays nobody is using it as a routine. Then, of course, beta radiation also earlier they were used for many types of glaucoma, mainly to reduce the wound healing in anti glaucoma surgery, and also photodynamic modulation also they have been tried. And of course, nowadays, this is one of the other important thing. Now people, all of us started using this collagen implants. Because some say because mitomycin is unpredictable, is because we have a lot of hypotony and other related complications. This is compared to mitomycin, it is very safe. That's what they claim. So this is a biodegradable collagen matrix implant. Is not an inhibitor of anti-fibrotic agents, not an inhibitor or anti-fibrotic agents. It's just a collagen matrix implant. And this implant is placed directly over the scleral flap. After suturing the scleral flap, you have to keep this implant over that area and then put the conjunctiva over that. Then you have to tightly close the conjunctiva flap. And this guides the fibroblast to grow randomly in the collagen matrix through its porous structure. This collagen implant, collagen will have a lot of porous opening in the body of the implant. So this fibroblast will grow into the body of this collagen matrix that results in the decreased scar formation because it will not affect the conjunctiva, it will go into the this collagen matrix. That's why there is a reduced scar formation and improved surgical success over the triple. That's the main concept of using the collagen. This is totally later on, you know, this is totally resolved within not within 3 months, it will take something to 6 months also. 6 months also it will take for the dissolution of this collagen implant. There is either alien that can cause inflammation or no inflammation, no chemical to kill the cell. Then there are few studies where you have used anti-VEGF. This is otherwise mainly used in so many retinal pathology like diabetic macular edema, AIRMD and all these. This is anti-vascular endothelial growth factor. Just to inhibit the vascular endothelial growth factor, we are using the same thing in the glaucoma also to inhibit the growth of the neural cells. That's a bevacizumab with Avastin. We use the subconjunctival as well as the injection also, but it's not equal to use of mitomycin. And previously we had used this type of steroid. This is called angiostatic steroid. This is a family of steroid only, but it doesn't have the property of the steroid like that ocular hypertensive effect. Most of the, some of the steroids, know that especially in steroid responders, they will have ocular hypertension and later on steroid dysglaucoma. Then this type of steroid, angiostatic steroid, no, that will not be with that, especially with the anacortive acetate. But main advantage, disadvantage of this steroid, the efficacy is not long lasting. It will not last for long time. That's why it has been not used continuously in anti-glaucoma surgery as well as in other retinal pathology. So to conclude, 5-FU and mitomycin, especially mitomycin, have increased the success of the glaucoma fixation surgery is all over the world, definitely. But we should keep it in mind, it's a double-edged sword because we must know about everything, about how much to use, how long to use, and to whom you should use, and how to manage the complications, and what are the complications you can expect by using the mitomycin. That all these things, unless you are not familiar, it's better not to use. That's the main thing with the, and also that's why it's a double-edged sword, so do good also, but like steroid only. But it has got a lot of other, we should know how to use. So a proper case selection and dose and exposure time is very, very important. And also you have to take into consideration about the age of the patient and the type of glaucoma and other local factors. So with this, you know, we come to the end of this class, this wound healing and role of antimetabolites in the glaucoma. But we should know about the normal wound healing and what are all the various pharmacological agents that will help to modulate the wound healing so that you can have a desirable filtering blood, and some of the agents that is commonly used in glaucoma and their side effects and the method of use. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any questions from any other center? Anomaly? Anomaly is there? Hello.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. There seems to be no questions from Pondicherry.
Very good, super. Okay. Madurai, Coimbatore, Tirupati. Sir, any question? Yes.
So practical, just one practical point, sir. So when you use mitomycin, do you use that sponge or it's better we use cotton
We have used because the sponge come in the bath. So when we started using mitomycin, we don't have a sponge at that time. So we have used the cotton only, but you should be very careful when you're using some, because sometimes the cotton fibers may get into the circumgenital space. So that can produce foreign body like reaction, or it may come out later, infected or something. So you should be very careful when you use it. Better always nowadays the sponge is freely available. No, sponge is better. And also it will imbibe more mitomycin than cotton.
Yes, that's my hypothesis is it absorbs the mitomycin, but whether it gives back to the subconjunctival space.
Yeah, because it is keeping contact with the subconjunctival tissue, no? And clear, no? So it definitely can. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other question? No other questions? Thank you very much. We'll see sometime later. Thank you. Thank you, Namalai Yandas.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for the wonderful talk.
Thank you.
We'll end the session, sir.